Good morning, good afternoon, depends on when you came to the museum. I'm Jack Hadley, the museum curator and the founder of the museum. And just want to give you a quick introduction of the museum as you come. And as you visit here today, I'm not going to go into details because I follow my little piece here. And I'm going to say you're going to have the video that's going to be recorded. And so in here, you're going to be amazing at what you see. It did not happen overnight. It took something like 40 years or so to be where we are today. And again, I want you to enjoy the museum and see everything, ask any questions to myself or to the staff, you know, and hope that I'm able to meet you if you're here. And so if I'm not here, it's because I'm in other places and doing business at the museum. So thank you for coming. And I just hope that you will enjoy everything. And thank you.
Black History Month, we introduce you to a man whose passion is teaching Americans about black culture and history. Maurice Estime has his story in today's feature at 5.
It's okay now for blacks to show their faces, but I think there was a point in time in our life we felt inferior about showing ourselves. You know what I mean?
Jack Hadley is the voice of the past, bringing to life unsung heroes. Through his extensive collection of photographs and artifacts, he's on a crusade to educate Americans about black history.
So all I want to do is expose you to it. And that's what I do on my whole collection.
This exposure has led to a passion to rediscover the past, a past that has not always been embraced, even in the black community.
And I recognize that our community was not really into collecting, not really into exhibiting our black faces. You know what I mean? I think it was sort of a situation where that we wasn't comfortable letting the community know that, hey, you know, we're proud, we're black people, we should be proud of what we have accomplished. So,
as he continues his life's mission to get black history into books and into the minds of the current generation, Jack Hadley has another mission: getting a permanent home for his collection.
So it's the joy that when I see in the kids' face that they really have not been able to be exposed to this, particularly for black kids, and because I feel as though that I'm doing something.
Now you can see its collection at the following locations: Thomas University, the Thomas County Library, the Southwestern State Hospital Center, and finally at Douglas Elementary, now until the end of the month.
Visit the exhibit was from California and was just rolling through town when they happened to stumble on Jack Hadley's collection.
This is an outstanding display, as I was telling Mr. Hadley, because he has women from the 1800s up until today. And normally, most places will have a section, you know, the 1800s. And then you come back 10 years later and they'll have the 1900s.
The exhibit officially opens tomorrow. You can also catch some of Jack Hadley's other displays at the Southwestern State Hospital, Douglas Elementary School, and the Thomas University Student Center. Hadley's collection includes about 1,800 pieces.
Martin Luther King Jr., Colin Powell, Barack Obama. These and many other names of national prominence come to mind when one thinks of black history. But only a certain amount of history gets made on a national stage. Before we elected our first black president, cities and towns across the United States were electing their first black mayors and councilmen. Over 100 years before Colin Powell became chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Thomasville's Henry Flipper became the first black graduate of the West Point Academy.
My focus here is to highlight our local black achievement and the first ones to accomplish. A lot of people come through this museum and they say that they're the first black in their community, but they would never be on the walls because there's no museum to highlight that.
This is the Jack Hadley Black History Museum in Thomasville, Georgia. Mr. Hadley has collected over 2,000 artifacts encompassing the achievements of both national and local figures.
actually a brief story that my son Jim, who is now 48 years old, we were stationed in Germany back in 1979. And Jim came home one day complaining about Black History Week and nothing was being done. And he and I put together a collage of articles cut out of Ebony Magazine, Jet Magazine, and Essence Magazine. And he paced them to the post board, he took them to school, and the teachers loved it, and the students as well. Then it gave me the idea to ask my squadron commander if we can do an exhibit in the barracks. And so my commander okayed this, and at Lindsay Air Station, Germany, is where we first did our exhibit.
From there, his collection grew.
Buffalo soldiers, you know, after slavery, the military activated the 9th and the 10th Cavalry. These guys, their job was to go out west and fight the Indians, but they were some craziest guys. The Indians gave them the name Buffalo because of their kinky hair. And because a buffalo is a courageous animal, these guys became courageous soldiers also.
One distinguished buffalo soldier hailed from Thomasville.
Is Lieutenant Henry O. Flipper. A lot of people don't realize that Lieutenant Flipper was born a slave here in Thomasville, Georgia in 1856. Became the first black officer in the United States Army. But those 4 years he spent at West Point, he received the silent treatment outside of the classroom. Now, you know, I can imagine, you know, walking to campus, nobody talked to you for 4 years. But when he got assigned, he went to Fort Davis, Texas, and during his job, he met a white girl, and they would go horseback riding on Sunday afternoon, and his peers did not like that. They set up a trap for him. Being a quartermaster, having money, something like $3,000 and some dollars came up missing. Lieutenant Flipper didn't report it. What he did was that he tried to put the money back.
He did this because he knew he was being set up. Unable to raise the full amount before his superiors would ask for it, he was court-martialed and dishonorably discharged. Despite this setback, however, Henry Flipper was able to accomplish quite a bit in his life.
Lieutenant Flipper became an engineer, he became a surveyor, he wrote books, edited paper, he would help build the Alaska Railroads, he went to Venezuela with the oil company, he was assistant secretary of interior. All of these things took place with a man or with a dishonorable discharge. Let's go to show you what kind of man he was.
Henry Flipper tried for years to clear his name, but with no success. Military exoneration would come posthumously in 1976. In 1999, President Clinton issued Lieutenant Flipper a full pardon. Some pieces in the collection are not only local, but also personal to Hadley.
My dad raised 14 kids out at Pepia on the Pepia Plantation Saturday. We lived in this house right here. This house still exists out on the plantation right here. This is Mrs. Pansy Allen here, who was the benevolent person on the plantation. Mrs. Pansy looked after the people on the plantation. If a student wanted to go to college, she would help foot that bill to the college. I got three sisters and a brother went to college. My dad didn't have to pay nothing. Okay, in this section here, Douglas High School and Thomas County School teachers here, we talk about different teachers during the segregated days, from early 1900s through the 1970s. Douglas High School is a predominantly black school from 1902 until 1970. That's when the blacks walked to the school from all over the city, 3 and 4 miles every day. No busing system, or either the parents had a mule and wagon, took them, or either old car, but that's how they got to school here at Douglas, by getting them walking those 3 or 4 miles. But we've come a long ways. They have produced some outstanding students, professional people.
In 2003, the Douglas High Alumni Association acquired the building from the school board and leased it to the museum.
We're very fortunate to have that. We thank those people that are really looking after us and our interests, because a lot of communities, their schools are boarded up and either run down. But we got this one here running. We're so blessed to have that.
Jack Hadley graduated from Douglas in 1956.
Picture myself and my wife and my senior year prom here. And that's the closest picture we got is marriage, because when we married at a family home in the country, and there was no big ceremony, so we always take this picture to be our wedding picture. This concludes my presentation. We try to do the best we can to show and, you know, let the people know that we do care, and we want to make sure that our history, African American history, is not lost.
For Dimensions, I'm Rob Diaz de Villegas.